Good morning, student. Today my topic is physis and facial injury. Myself, Dr. Sagar Kesi. I think now I'd like to start the class. Okay. Now I'll be talking some basic difference between children bone and the adult bone. Okay. So as you can see in the presentation, in the children bones, they have thick joint cartilage as compared to the adult one. So they are not seen in the X-ray. Similarly, they have got thick periosteum. So due to this, their healing will be more rapid and more fast in case of children. Similarly, there will be more collagen, and this leads to the easy fracture in the children bone. And more on, and they have got more cancellous bone. And due to this, there will be simple fracture pattern. And the main topic of today's presentation, the growth plate, the presence of the growth plate, that is the peculiar picture of the children bone. And this, the growth plate helps in the longitudinal growth of the bone and also remodels any deformity present in the children. Okay. Then similarly, the ligament, which are more stronger than the children. So the bone fails first. Now, due to this, there will be fracture. There will be fracture and later only the ligament injury, which is different from the adult bone. Now coming to the more property of the children bone. There is higher water content, lower mineral per unit volume. Due to this, there will be lower modulus of elasticity. It will be less brittle and higher ultimate strength to failure. This is basically a brief introduction about the pediatric bone. You can see the articular cartilage in the proximal end, the cancellous bone, the epiphyseal plate, that is the physis, the metaphysis, the middle part is the diaphysis, and the as you can see in the picture, there are two lateral, two physis at the lateral end. Physis is a unique cartilaginous structure that varies in thickness depending on age and location. And then these physis are weaker than the bone in terms of torsion, shearing, and bending force. So there is more chance of injury in this delicate area. Okay. And talking about the periosteum, the bone is covered by the periosteum, okay, the outer the periosteum, which is thick in the case of children, and they are present all over the bone except in the articular ends. And talking about the periosteum, it continues to the physis at the lateral end. Okay, at the lateral end of the physis, there is a perichondral ring, that is a part of the periosteum that forms the ring of Lacquer's. It may be asked in your MCQ. Okay. The ring of Lacquer's is the basically the periosteum present at the lateral end of the physis. The periosteum, talking about the periosteum, it has got two layers, the outer fibrous layer and the inner cambium layer. The fibrous layer, which is attached to the muscle, tendon, ligament, the inner cambium layer, which has the property of osteogenesis, that is, it can produce bone cell, that is osteoblast. Coming, talking about the apophysis, this is also a type of physis, but the main role of apophysis is it helps in the growth of the girth. Okay, the physis helps in the longitudinal growth, but the apophysis helps in the lateral growth. That is the girth. The girth of the bone is increased by the apophysis. This is basically the contribution of the physis in the upper arm and in the lower limb. Upper limb and the lower limb. You can see in the slide. The 80% of the total length of humerus is contributed by the upper proximal part. Okay, so mainly the growth is contributed by the proximal part of the humerus and the distal part of the radius and ulna in the upper limb. Whereas in the lower limb, the main contribution is done by the distal part of the femur and the proximal part of the tibia. This is one of the important thing you need to notice. Okay, in the upper limb, it is the proximal part of the humerus and the distal part of the radius and ulna, which contribute to the maximum growth. And in the lower limb, that is the distal part of the femur and the proximal part of the tibia. So knee joint, around the knee joint, it contributes more growth in the lower limb. Now talking about the anatomic part of the child bone, there is a epiphysis that I have shown, as I have shown in the figure, the epiphysis, which is present in the ends and the ends, okay, and then it is the epiphysis. Now coming to the today's main topic, okay, this is the main topic. This is the anatomy showing the epiphysis and epiphyseal growth plate. Okay, as you can see, in the upper part there is a articular cartilage, which forms the joint. Okay, with another bone, it forms the joint. And after the articular cartilage, there is the epiphyseal growth plate. Okay, there is one is the longitudinal growth plate, that is physis, and another one is the epiphyseal growth plate, which is spherical. Okay, basically there are two physis on the articular end. Okay, now coming to the physis proper, that is the longitudinal or horizontal physis. There are basically three parts. Okay, the anatomy classification, basically there are three parts. One is reserve zone, another one is the proliferative zone, and another one is the hypertrophic zone. Okay, the reserve zone, it consists of the food particle, basically provided for the osteoblast, like the glycogen. It is the storage form, reserve zone. Another one is the proliferative zone, and the third part is the hypertrophic zone, which is further divided into maturation zone, degeneration zone, and zone of provisional calcification. Basically, the name dictates its own function or role. Okay, in the reserve zone, there is a food material, there is the glycogen, which is necessary for the development of the osteoblast. Okay, and the proliferative zone, where the proliferation of the osteoblast takes place. Okay, that is for the bone growth. And another one is the maturation, degenerative, and zone of provisional calcification, which lies under the hypertrophic zone. I'll be talking about some pathology regarding the zone of the physis later. Okay, and the metaphysis consists of the primary spongiosa and secondary spongiosa. Basically, what I am telling here is you should know the epiphysis, the epiphyseal growth plate, the physis, and the metaphysis part. Okay, and the classification of the anatomical classification of the physis, longitudinal physis. Now, coming to the physis, as I have already mentioned, there is basically two types of growth plate. Okay, two types of growth plate. One is the horizontal, which is physis, which I have talked, and one is the spherical. I think I like to take back the previous slide. You can see there is a spherical physis just below the articular cartilage. I think you can appreciate that is the spherical physis. Okay, below the articular cartilage. And another one, the longitudinal physis lies below the secondary ossification center. That is the reserve, proliferative, and the hypertrophic zone. Okay, the spherical plate is less organized than the horizontal plate. So the horizontal plate is more responsible for the longitudinal growth rather than the spherical plate. And the perichondrial artery is the major source of nutrition for the growth plate. Now, coming to the part of the physis. In the reserve zone, where there is the matrix production and storage takes place, if there is some defect, okay, there is defect in type 2 collagen, then this is like diastropic dwarfism, pseudoachondroplasia, Nish syndrome, this occurs. Okay, these are some examples if there is defect in reserve zone. Similarly, in the proliferative zone, where the matrix production takes place, if there is some problem, if there is defect, then gigantism, achondroplasia, hypochondroplasia, malnutrition, these are some diseases. Okay, if there is some problem in the proliferative zone. And basically, the important one for you is the zone of the provisional calcification, where there is the function is the calcification of the matrix occurs in the zone of provisional calcification, as the name suggests. Okay, and if there is insufficiency of calcium, for normal calcification of matrix, if there is insufficiency of calcium, then the disease like rickets, osteomalacia, I think you have heard about it, that may occur. Okay, if there is some problem, there is defect, there is insufficiency of calcium. Okay, and another one is the primary spongiosa and secondary spongiosa. In rickets and osteomalacia, the main thing is there is insufficiency of calcium, and then due to that there will be lack of normal calcification. Okay, this is some important point for you. Now coming to the metaphysis. A metaphysis is a flared part of the bone. Okay, at each end of the diaphysis. Okay, it has decreased cortical thickness and increased volume of trabecular bone. Okay, and that is the secondary spongiosa. It has got two parts. There is primary spongiosa and secondary spongiosa. Diaphysis, it constitutes a major portion of the long bone. It is formed by bone remodeled from metaphysis. Okay, and it developing diaphyseal bone is extremely vascular. Okay, and there is subsequent growth lead to increased complexity of the Aversian osteoinal system. I think there will be another topic regarding this Aversian canal system. Today I'll be more talking about the physial injury only. Okay, So just for your reminder, there is epiphysis, physis, metaphysis, and diaphysis. Okay, I think you know about that part. Now coming to my main topic, okay, this is the physical injuries. How does the physical injury occur, or what are the etiology of physical injury? You can see the main cause is the fracture, okay, from direct injury, from trauma, okay. Another one is the infection, right, like osteomyelitis, okay, or septic arthritis, okay. And then third point is like some space occupying lesion like tumor, cyst, or tumor like condition, okay. Similarly, vascular insult, okay, there can be a vascular necrosis, okay. And there is repetitive stress, like in some marathon runner or something like in army personnel, there can be repetitive stress, okay, and that can cause, okay, decisive injury. And sometimes the irradiation may cause the physical injury. Now directly coming to the classification, okay, you just need to know the name, okay. The most important one here is the Salter and Harris and Ogden classification. There are some other classifications like Poland, Atkin, okay. It's better to know, but you must know about Salter, Harris, and Ogden classification. I'll be talking about it, okay. So there are other classifications like Poland, Atkin, okay. Now I'll be talking about the Salter and Harris, okay. It was given in 1963, okay. So it has got five type, okay. The first type is, as you can see in the picture, did you see there is type 1, okay, in which there is epiphyseal separation. You can see the fracture line without metaphyseal fragment, okay. I think there is more clearer picture here, okay. There is type 1, okay. There is epiphyseal separation without metaphyseal fragment, okay. The two, in type 2, you can see there is physeal fracture which extend into the metaphysis, okay. In this picture, you can see type 2, there is a physeal fracture which is extending upward, okay. That is the metaphyseal spike, okay. That is grade 2. Now coming to the grade 3, there is a physeal fracture extending to the joint. You can see that the distal part, the down part of the joint, okay, that is the epiphysis. The fracture extending from the physis to the epiphysis, that is grade 3, okay. Now coming to the grade 4, there is a through and through fracture, okay, from the epiphysis, from the physis, and coming to the metaphysis, that is grade 4, okay. Now the grade 5. In grade 5, there is extensive comminution. Okay, I think some may not appreciate in the X-ray, in the picture, there is extra comminution of the physis. Okay, due to this, there may be the physial shadows in the X-ray will be decreased. Okay, and sometimes this will lead to the diminish in the growth. Okay, there will be less growth, and that can be later seen in the X-ray. There will be premature physis closure, okay. There will be cross injury. There will be extensive comminution of the physis that may not be seen initially in the X-ray, but it has got poor prognosis. You need to remember that, okay. Sometimes the type 5 Salter Harris will not be seen in the X-ray, but later the patient may come with a short limb or short limb. Okay. So you need to be careful about this cross injury of type 5. Now there is another, okay. I want to introduce you to the Ogden classification. Ogden type 5 up to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is similar to Salter and Harris, but Ogden has added type 6, type 7, type 8, and type 9. Okay, it is the Ogden modification of Salter Harris. Okay, so basically, we have learned Salter and Harris, and then extra you need to know is the Ogden classification. Okay, Ogden classification up to 5 is similar to the Salter and Harris, but Ogden has added it. Type 6, type 7, type 8, and type 9. Type 6 is the perichondrial ring injury, okay? As I have already mentioned before, the periosteum, which is present over the lateral end of the physis, okay? I think I have previously mentioned in the previous slide, there is something called Lacroix, okay? At Lacroix, the perichondrial ring can get injured, which is present at the periphery of the physis, okay? That is type 6, that is kept under type 6. Now type 7. There is a osteochondral fracture and epiphyseal avulsion with epiphysis fracture. Okay, in this case you may not see physical injury. You may not see fracture line in the physis, but there will be an epiphyseal fracture, and you just leave it like there is no physical injury. But so you may be missing the injury. So epiphyseal fracture with osteochondral fracture and epiphyseal avulsion may also have physical fracture. So it is kept under type 7. Okay. Type 8 is metaphyseal fracture with physeal injury. And you may not see in the X-ray. Okay, you may not see that actually the physis are normal, but there is metaphysis, there is only metaphysic fracture, but there is association of metaphysic fracture with physis. That is kept under type 8. And similarly, type 9, that is a diaphyseal fracture with physial injury. Basically, this classification is given because many of the time actually we don't see the physical injury. These are the associated injury, and we should think if these injuries are present, then there may be physical injury. Now coming to the epidemiology of physical fracture, this is more 20-30% of all childhood fracture, and more represent in the finger phalanxes, more and then distal radius. Upper extremity is more common, 71%, and then the lower extremity, okay, and male is to female, 2:1, okay, and the male has more propensity to have physial fracture, okay. Now, coming to the physial growth disturbances, okay, what are the, in which cases there may be the growth disturbances, okay. One is the physical loss of the physis. Here it has written the Peterson type, okay, basically Salter and Harris type 4, okay, type 4, type 5, and then the Ogden classification, I have talked about the modification. No? So in this case, there may be the physical loss of the physis, okay. And another one is the disruption of normal physial architecture, okay. This may lead to the physical growth disturbance. And another one is formation of physial arrest, bony bridge, and physial bar, okay. Associated with vascular disruption, infection, distraction with space occupying lesion like unicameral bone cyst, inchondroma, infantile blount disease, purpura fulminans, and irradiation. Okay. These are associated other conditions that may lead to physial growth disturbances. Now, how will you evaluate a case of physial growth disturbance? Because there is some injury, there is some growth disturbance, there is some injury in the physis, and there will be some growth disturbance. Now, how will you evaluate it? Okay. So the first investigation we would like to do is a radiograph. Okay, you would like to take a X-ray, and then you will note the following points, like the loss of normal physial contour. Okay, you can always compare to the normal side. Okay, if there is some fracture or some injury over the left side, then you can take the right side as a normal, and you can compare it. Okay. So you can compare and see if there is any loss of normal physical contour. Okay. Now another one is the sharply defined radiolucency. Okay. There will be, if there is a fracture, then it will be seen as a radiolucency. Okay. The black part. Okay. In the X-ray, you will see it as a black part between the epiphyseal and the metaphyseal bone. Okay. And another one is the, if there is frank physical arrest. Okay. If the physical arrest has already been taken place, then they will be characterized by a sclerotic. That is the radiopaque. Okay. Radiopaque density seen in the X-ray in the region of the arrest. Now, similarly, other investigation is CT scan. Okay, so one is CT scan, another one is the MRI. Okay, by a CT scan, you will know about the extent of bone bridging physis. Okay, if there is any physical arrest, if there is any sclerotic part, then the extent, how much it has extended. Okay, that part you can assess easily by a CT scan. Okay, and another is the MRI. MRI, as it is more friendly. Okay. It is less invasive. It also helps to assess organization of a residual physis. Okay, the extent of it also helps to assess the extent and organization of the residual physis. How much physis has left? How much has damaged? And if there is any physial bar, then if you are going to take out the physial bar, then it will help to assess the extent. So, doing an MRI before a operative treatment is like it is a good modality. Okay, it is a good modality of investigation. Now, coming to the principle, okay, this is a general principle of operative fracture treatment in children. Basically, I think there are some 13-14 points which will tell the principle, okay, how are you going to fix the children fracture, okay, children fracture, how are you doing it, what are the special thing you would like to follow while fixing the children bone, okay. You should always think that all fracture in the children will not remodel itself, okay. So adequate reduction is always necessary. Okay, so you do not think that all fracture and children remodel completely, and that adequate reduction is unnecessary. This is the first point and the most important point, I think. Okay, and you should know the special surgical anatomy of physis. Each physis, besides being undulated, also is unique in contour at each joint, and it's not just a flat plate. Okay, people may consider it just like a flat plate. Okay, it's not like that. Okay? You should know the special surgical anatomy. You should know it is in the upper part of the humerus, or in the elbow, or in the distal radius. And as I have shown you in the picture previously, the contribution of the physis in the upper limb, lower limb is different. Okay, so if there is injury over the humerus and in the distal radius in the upper limb, then there is more chance of physial injury rather than if there is injury over the elbow. Okay, so you should distinguish like that. Similarly, in the lower limb, if there is injury over the neck, in the femur, in the upper part of femur, and in the distal tibia, then it is less chance of physial arrest. Okay? But there is more chance of there is injury over the distal femur or in the proximal tibia. Okay, I think you get it. Okay, I have kept in the previous picture. No? So you should think of this. You should know the special surgical anatomy of the physis. Which physis contributes more to the growth? Which physis contributes less to the growth? You should consider it before doing a operative treatment. Okay. Now coming to the open reduction, if necessary. Open reduction basically opening the fracture. Okay. If an open reduction is necessary, we should reposition the fragment as anatomical as possible. Okay. We should reposition the fragment as anatomical as possible. This is especially important at the physis. Okay. The cartilaginous fragment should be in anatomical position. Otherwise, the resulting offset would cause bony breeze. Okay. I'll be talking later about the bony breeze and okay, and then the joint continuity. So always we need to reposition the fragment as anatomical as possible. Another point, okay, we need to use adequate fixation but not more than necessary. Okay, keeping in mind that the possibility of early mobilization in certain situation. Okay, you need to have adequate fixation so that you can do a early mobilization of the joint. Okay, you should keep in that mind. Now, huge fixation that can be removed easily. Like in the case of children, it's better to use a K-wire, okay, rather than the plate, nail, or other instrument, okay, other implant, okay. It's better to use a K-wire because it will provide a good stability and also you can easily remove it, okay. You don't need to take the patient to the operating room, okay. So as you can see in the picture, I think you can, everybody can appreciate the picture. There is a screw, okay. There is a screw which has got thread and the thread has passed the fracture, okay. That will cause the compression there, okay. So the physis, you can see in the line, upper line, that has not been violated by the screw, okay. And the threaded pins, the cancellous screw threaded pin are used, okay. They have crossed the epiphysis and the metaphysis, but the physis has not been violated, okay. So, and another point is, we need to use smooth rather than threaded pin when possible. You can use threaded pin, but when possible, you need to use a smooth pin like the K-wires. And we should not try to cross the physis. Rather, we can go parallel to the epiphysis, okay, or pin fracture spike in the metaphysis, okay. Rather, we need to go parallel to the physis, okay. As you can see the picture, the screw is parallel to the physis. It's holding the epiphyseal part, okay, epiphyseal fracture very strongly, okay. And other, we need to avoid unnecessary drilling holes, okay. Later, it may cause pathological fracture, okay. Because when the child plays, when the child starts to walk, the hole we have drilled may create a pathological fracture. Similarly, we need to avoid pin, okay, the K-wire penetrating into the joint, okay. We need to avoid the K-wire into the joint. And we should use plastic type of closure with absorbable suture, because the suture will be absorbed and another, there will be no, like, we don't need to remove the suture later. It will be easier. Basically, it will be easier, okay. And we need to immobilize a non-compliant child adequately, okay, because the child may be active, they may play, they may again cause fracture. So we need to protect the fracture. We may need to put a plaster, we may need to put a cast in the patient who are not, in the child who are not compliant. We should look for the neurovascular insufficiency during the recovery period, okay. Like we need to look for the nerve, we need to look for the blood supply distal to the fracture, okay. We need to observe for it. Okay. And we need to warn the patient about early operative complications like bony bridge formation, angular deformity, and posterior necrosis before they develop. Okay, because in case of physis, there may be the bony bridge formation can occur, there may be angular deformity. So we need to counsel early about the patient, because the patient, the mother, the parents may get like they may get irritated or they may get non-compliant. So we need to tell them previously what are the complications that can arise. Okay. Now coming to the physial arrest. Okay, this physial arrest basically occurs due to the inappropriate approximation of the physis, or sometimes the severe injury of the physis, they may get the breeze of the bone may develop across the portion of the physis. Okay, that lead to the tethering of the epiphyseal and metaphyseal bone. Okay, so this is the bony breeze formation that occurs in the physis. This physial arrest of the bony breeze can be classified as central, peripheral, or linear. Okay, in central there is tenting of the articular surface. In peripheral there is angular deformation, and there will be the shortening of the limb. Okay, and another one is the linear arrest, which is basically the combination of central and peripheral. Okay, so how can we prevent this physial arrest? The first one is we need to get a to prevent a physial arrest or bony breeze formation. We need to first do a gentle anatomical and secure reduction of fracture, especially the saltar arteries 3 and 4. Okay, the main thing is we need to do an gentle anatomic and secure reduction of the fracture. If there is any damaged epiphysis, okay, we need to protect by a fat wrap. Okay, there will be a fat wrap, and it should be used in case of damaged exposed epiphysis. Similarly, there is empiric therapy. We can use the indomethacin. Okay, that is an empiric therapy which will prevent the formation of physial arrest. Okay, this is a medical prevention. Okay, medical prevention method. Similarly, now another is if there is already a partial physis formation. Okay, if there is already a partial physial formation, we need to do a resection. Okay, and we can do a physiolysis, epiphysiolysis, to restore normal growth of the affected physis. Okay, and the principle is to remove the bone tether, the bony breeze between the metaphysis and physis. Okay, and the defect, after you remove the bony breeze or the physial arrest part, then there will be a gap. Okay, and you can use a fat wrap or a retardant. Okay, the retardant, there is bone formation retardant, like you can use a fat wrap also. Okay, and the residual epiphysis will remove the normal longitudinal growth. Okay, so this is a partial physial arrest resection, resecting the bony breeze. Now coming to the another modality is a physial distraction. Just need to know the name. Okay, this is not very important. Sometimes we can use an external fixator. Okay, spanning and distraction, which will cause the complete arrest of the physis. Okay, so this will later help in the correction of the deformity. Okay, so if you distract the physis and make it arrest, there will be complete arrest, then the deformity will be not more. Okay, and then later we can do a corrective osteotomy. So this is a modality and not much important. Okay, you need to know the name. There is something called physial distraction for the management of growth arrest, for the growth arrest. Repeated osteotomy. This is once the physis has fused, and if there is any angular deformity or if there is any shortening, then you need to do a repeated osteotomy. Okay, during the growth. Okay, this is some corrective osteotomy. Just know that you need to do a corrective osteotomy of the metaphysis. Okay, if there is some angular deformity. Okay, similarly, the completion of epiphysiodesis and management of resulting limb and discrepancy. Okay, another one is if there is shortening of the limb and the affected physis is already injured, then you can do a opposite side contralateral epiphysiodesis, so that the existing discrepancy is tolerable and lengthening is not desired. Okay, I think you didn't get it because it's not much of a popular method. If the right side of the physis is injured, then there will be no growth in the right side. Okay, and basically there will be less growth in the right side. So what this method suggests is that you need to do a fusion of the physis. You need to fuse the physis of the left side, so there will be no growth in the left side. So this will equal the normally this will not equal, but like there will be tolerable. Okay, that discrepancy will be tolerable, and later you can do a lengthening procedure and to equal the length. So opposite side physis will be surgically destroyed, and the limb length will be slightly corrected. Okay, that is the epiphysiodesis and contralateral epiphysiodesis. Now, indication of physial arrest resection. These are some indications when you need to do a physial arrest resection. These are the infection, tumor, peripheral arrest has more we need to do a resection more in a peripheral arrest than central arrest. Okay, and distal TBI is more favorable resumption of growth than distal femoral part. Okay, distal TBI has more favorable outcome. As you know, the main growth in the lower limb is the distal femur. Okay, so if there is distal femoral fascial part, then the growth will be hampered more than the distal TBI. I think I have already mentioned you earlier also. And arrest affecting more than 25%, okay, of the total surface area are unlikely to grow. So you need to do a facial resection. Okay. And if there is more than 2 years of growth remaining based on the skeletal age, okay, so that is also indication for facial arrest resection. Now coming to the take home message. Okay. So I think you have got some idea, you have got some knowledge, okay, about the facies. It's a little bit a dry topic for you, and furthermore, we will be teaching you on the word, okay, in your next classes. Main thing is the facial fracture are common, okay. These are the one of the common injury in the childhood, okay, and have favorable outcome without long term sequelae. Most of the facial injury have favorable outcome if treated properly, okay, and you need to treat it gently and expertly to maximize restoration of normal limb function and longitudinal growth, okay. And then last but not the least, okay, but last but the most, you need to learn the anatomy properly and respect the mother nature, because the nature has created the facies, okay, so magnetic, so like so properly, so you need to respect the anatomy, you need to learn the anatomy and respect the mother nature, right? And it will itself grow and remodel itself, okay, because in children the deformity will be corrected slowly, okay, slowly by the facies, okay. So facies, I think this much for today's class.